I'm going to be talking a little bit about getting your name slandered. Getting your good, wonderful name a slander. And so, oftentimes when we as Christians read about fruit of Christianity, we always are referred to Galatians chapter 5, where the Bible speaks of love, joy, peace. This is the fruit of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
There's other picture or pieces to the jigsaw puzzle that we need to add. And one of the pieces that we need to add to being fruit of being a true Christian is your name is going to be slandered. Amen. Your name is going to be defamed. And many of you come from maybe a smaller city, a small county. Maybe you don't have as many churches as other churches in other states, other counties, and they reject you for who you are. And I understand that. I understand how churches can reject you and gossip and slander about you. Heathen can say stuff. Anytime you feel bad and lonely in the county that you live in, just consider me. I'm in Los Angeles, and we had 12, 15 million people in our county, and wow, there's a lot of slandering that goes on with my name. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of people that consider me a cult. There's a lot of people that don't like what we say. And a lot of this is because of what we believe and how aggressive we are. We went in front of, stood in front of a lot of these churches, from Chuck Smith to Pastor McGee. We used to go in front of their churches in the mid-80s and preach. God sets you up to be a beacon, and you are failing here. And they would slander our name, try to make things up. But throughout the Bible, men of God have been slandered.
Amen.
The Bible teaches all our enemies have opened their mouths against us. Lamentation 3:46. All of our enemies have opened their mouths against us.
Amen.
I'd like to say, if you are concerned about preaching in public, and you are concerned about what other people might think about you, open air preaching is not for you.
That's right.
I would suggest that you would minister to possibly feeding the homeless or visiting someone in the hospital where your labor would be welcomed. If you are concerned what others will write about you, I say street preaching is not for you.
That's right.
Perhaps you should invest your time in music ministry, maybe lead a youth group, maybe the local churches will appreciate what you do. If you are concerned about your good name getting tainted, I suggest proclaiming Jesus in the modern day marketplace is not for you. I strongly urge that. Maybe you should sit on a few religious committees, and that would help keep your sacred name pure. Anyone who preaches in public will have a foul name. As the days of preachers before us, when men of God preached, and we read these history books, and revival took place, you need to understand, that's the exception and not the rule. The rule is, these guys were hated. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes we read these fantastic preaching history stories, it's just the exception that revival took place. Jesse gave a little rundown of how many guys had responded based upon his preaching. We've got the same testimony. We've got testimony of heathen on Bourbon Street crying out, giving their heart to the Lord. We've given them the microphone and they confessed exactly what happened. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't do this without testimonies. But I want to say this. In all my 30 years and plus of preaching, if I've never had one person repent, it would not alter what I do.
That's right.
In all my 30 years of preaching, if I never had one email that said, "Brother, well, because I heard you and saw you, I repented," I would not alter anything I've ever said.
That's right.
In all my years of preaching in front of churches or at churches or from behind a pulpit, and have somebody not in the congregation ever come up and say, "Man, I saw you 12 years ago, 15 years ago." In fact, I've been to churches where I've had people come up and say, I actually threw beer on you, and I'm in a church. If I never had that testimony, it would never alter what I do for God. It doesn't influence me at all. And so I understand by reading the Bible, your name is going to be slandered. These are just the exceptions. That's not the rule. The rule is they're going to hate us. And I don't have this mentality of doing this. It's just I understand the cost that I'm taking. I understand I'm paving my way, and I'm wiring my wife so that when I die, it's not going to be an open casket. By the time the heathen have their way with me, it's going to be a closed casket. The problem is I'm not dead by the time they stop. I've been dead when I first gave my heart to the Lord.
That's right.
I've been dead a long time ago.
Amen.
You're looking and hearing at a dead man.
Oh, yeah.
I've been dead a long. The hardest preach I've ever done was the first preach when I was 18 years old, and I stood in front of the actual church I grew up in, and I preached, and I preached. I actually knew them by name, and I'm calling people out by name. They're my neighbors. I went to school with them. My mom was in the church, and I'm out there preaching. And instantly, my name was getting slandered.
Yeah.
Within minutes of me preaching, my name was getting slandered. If you think you want to go involved and get involved and invest your life in open-air preaching, and you are concerned about a good name, and I understand that, but this type of preaching is not for you.
Right.
I would suggest that possibly a puppet show for Jesus would be giving hot chocolate for Jesus. I strongly recommend that because you don't know what you're getting into. And so we do need to understand what it is that we're doing. When you take that task and you put your hands to this plow, there's going to be some rocky ground.
Amen.
Where God beckons guys like us to get into. You know, you just don't just plant the seed. There's rocky ground. There's mountains that need to be dynamited. It's a hard hat glove area. There's a lot of emergency vehicles. There's blasting. We have to remove trees before we can even put that seed in that ground. And if you can't handle that, I understand. I suggest you just stay home with grandma and help do some weeding around the flower box. But stay away from the hard field. Don't get in our way. Just put on a knee pad and remove a couple of weeds there around the flower box with grandma. Somebody's got to do that. I'm not saying that's wrong.
Yeah.
But when you come over to our field where the ground is very rocky and we don't have the luxury of just walking around planting seeds,
right.
We've got a work order that mountain has to be removed. We got to bang it down.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to get trucks to get that gravel out of here.
Amen.
Amen.
It's a little bit more work involved when guys like us who are found in the Bible, and they have to plant that seed. If you are really concerned about your good reputation, don't do that. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 20, "For since I spake, I cried out, I cried violence and spoil, because the word of the Lord was made a reproach unto me." Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 20, verse 8, that he was daily a mock. He was daily getting insults. This is a man of God, you know, so he didn't have prosperity. He wasn't loved by everybody. He was daily mocked.
Amen.
Jeremiah was reproached because he spoke what God wanted him to say.
Okay.
He writes, "To whom shall I speak and give warning that they may hear? Behold, their ear is uncircumcised and they cannot hearken. Behold, the word of the Lord is unto them a reproach, and they have no delight in it."
Amen.
You have to understand, if you volunteered for this, or God has quickened your spirit to do this, you better count the cost of what it takes, because you're going to be hated. And sometimes when we read about these saints, the hatred and the problem and the slander and the gossip can come from Christians. Your friendly fire, we expect it from heathen. And don't stop there. It can come from your own family.
Yes.
There are families that I've known after 30 years of rubbing elbows with a lot of families. There's families that I've known who raised their kids properly. And at a certain age, when that child gets out of the house, he slams that family. You think you're raising your kids now? God bless you. Let me tell you, when they hit 18, 19 years old and they wish to get out of that house, things get said. Parents get slammed. And don't think you're immune to it.
Amen.
You cannot go in the devil's sandbox and kick sand in his face without him coming into your home. If you really make the impact that you think you did, you better expect it. You better prepare for it. Because it's coming.
Amen.
It's coming. Those kids that are loving you now, when they get upset with you and they're of age and they decide to leave your house, those same kids can slander your name.
Amen.
I've seen it. I've seen it, and that's like an Achilles heel. It destroys a father and mother when they're out there saying this. And then, of course, you have people that already hate you. They're feeding on this stuff. They're really eating this stuff up.
Mm-hmm.
We have stories of men of God in the Bible, of slander. Slander doesn't just happen between Jesus and the Pharisees. It was with Cain and Abel. It was with Joseph and his brothers, Jacob and Esau. It was with David and Saul. It was with Job and his wife and close friends. Most of the men that walked with Jesus were considered a cult because they abided in God. Oftentimes people say, if you're a cult, just go to California. You'll have a lot of followers, and you'll be a millionaire. Well, I got one out of three. I do live in California, and I've been called a cult I don't know how many times. But I definitely don't have the million followers, and I'm not a millionaire by any means. I'm barely 100-aire, if anything.
Amen.
The stories and faces of slander will go on. The faces will always change, but that spirit of slander is always going to be out there. Today you can be slandered by a newspaper article. News stories, blogs, YouTubes, newsletters from the pulpit. Your friends, family, co-workers, fellow laborers. I've even had a track where they actually had my picture and they're passing out where I'm preaching. Went into a city and there's these guys passing out literature, talking to people. I'm assuming they're Christians and they're kind of just working my crowd until one of them sheepishly gave me a track and, hey, there's my picture on it.
Yeah.
Actually make a pit. You've made such of an impact. Somebody is actually making a track with your name and why you're a heretic and why you're a child of the devil. The Bible teaches in Proverbs chapter 6, six things do it the Lord hates. Seven
Amen.
Are an abomination.
Amen.
Unto him, a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that deceiveth wickedness, wicked imaginations, feet that are swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaks lies, and he that soweth discord among the brethren.
Amen.
Anybody who has issues with God hating actual people need to reread Proverbs 6.
Amen.
A proud look is an actual person.
Amen.
A lying tongue is a body part from a human. Hands actually belong to a man. A heart with wickedness is part of our human body. Feet running the mischief, that's a human body part. A false witness is a person. You add these components up, he's talking about a man. This verse is saying God can hate an actual man, not just their sin. God hates six of them, but the seventh is an abomination. This tells us that word, if we use the Bible to define Bible, that word abomination is even a little bit heavier than hateful in God's opinion.
Right.
And one of the things that really is hateful to God is that person who sows discord among the brethren. It's in the Bible, fellas. And you'll find some Christians that really love to slander me. And they really think it's the will of God. I gave them a reason to live. They're going to go out of their way to do God's will to try to shut me up or slander me. And, you know, after 30 years with the many ministries that we have, most of the slander is not that I've been a homosexual, not that I've cheated on my secretary, not that I've stolen money from the church. They don't like my sign. That's their slander. Right. They don't like what I say. They didn't like my t-shirt. I can live with that. That's not, there's some real problems. If that's all they're saying, I can live with that. That's not that big of a thing. People are going to slander you all the time. Amen. They'll go out of their way. Don't take it personal.
That's right.
The Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, blessed are ye when men shall speak, when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Now everybody's familiar with that text in Matthew 11 and 12, but yet they're shocked when somebody writes something about them. They're shocked that somebody has said something about them. They're shocked that there's some gossip going on about you. I mean, if we really sincerely subscribe to the Bible, you better expect it. You better expect not to be a very welcome guy in certain areas.
Amen.
There's times I'll walk into a church group and it's like, you know, I hadn't taken a shower in 20 years. People will just kind of walk away, you know, and kind of just, I'm kind of by myself. They just don't want to hang around with you or associate you in a little gossip. Well, we had heard this, we had heard that. Hardly anybody ever checks up on anything.
Right.
If I had to go over just on the internet and respond to every email, every post, every YouTube clip, every Facebook comment, every blog, every chat room, I would need a staff of 5 or 6 people, 40 hours a day, all year long, just to respond. You don't think that's true? Just Google Reuben Israel, Los Angeles.
Done it.
You'll spend hours over all the things that have written about me. Some of the stuff I don't even know. They know more about me than I know. But again, it doesn't affect me. And I mentioned this on the first time I was preaching, because I judge me harder than they do. Besides God, I judge me very hard. When I go to bed at night, I ponder everything that I say. Yeah, I know I probably went too far when I said that. I shouldn't have said that. Take me back out, get me back out of that bullpen, put me back on that mountain, that won't happen again. I know I did this. I judge me harder than anybody else can other than God. And so there's not much they can say. But again, you have to expect the slander. And it's going to even come from your own home, your own family, your own children, your own wife. You better expect it. If you can't handle it, I urge you, for heaven's sake, just, you know, do something else in Christianity. The body of Christ is large. But understand, when you grab a hold of the plow that we're doing now, it's going to affect you.
Amen.
As it affected many of these men that we're reading about. Peter writes in his epistle, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and God resteth upon you. Jesus said, rejoice. Peter says, be happy. And yet, when you have Christians getting slandered, they're absolutely shocked. If I tell you how many phone calls I get from some open-air preacher, I just had my church tell me this. I just had my church tell me, they should rejoice. You know, they are reading the same field manual as I am. Mm-hmm. And if we're reading the same field manual, we should expect this.
Amen.
This is what we've been wired to do. When we get dropped off behind enemy lines, it's all that training that has us get up off the foxhole and fire back at the enemy. You don't just curl up like a little girl and urinate in your pants when there's a battle going on. Mm-hmm. All that training, you get up and you fight right back.
Man.
This is why we're waxed strong in God. And if you say you believe the book, as we believe the book, if this is the field manual, you better expect this stuff. You're not going to get a group hug from me. If anything, I'm kind of shocked. You've been a Christian for 14 years and you're waving a letter that somebody has emailed about your name. Boy, I can send you 500 just last week about me. Imagine if Jesus Christ was alive. Some of the things that he said.
Right.
Jesus said, "Let the blind lead the blind." I mean, that may not sound too wild back then. Had Jesus Christ made that statement today, CNN would demand an apology. You have just said something about the poor blind people, Jesus.
Right.
The Braille Institute would be out there picketing what Jesus Christ says, demanding an apology.
Right.
How dare you, the blind leading the blind, they both fall into the pit. That's horrible. Can you imagine 80, 90 people from the Braille Institute coming out and picketing Jesus? They're walking around with their signs upside down. They're holding, bumping into each other. They don't know what's going on. They're screaming, and somebody's got to position him. He's over this way. They're upset at Jesus because of that statement. We read it as Christians. He said, "Let the blind lead the blind." That's an insulting thing to say. Can you imagine the slander that our Lord would have had just by that one statement? Oh, I would have liked to see that protest. I've seen a lot of them, but I'd like to see that when that came out. The number of sites that have accused me of being a Pharisee, a heretic, demonic, unloving, tool of Satan, hater, bully, false teacher, cruel, unorthodox, false prophet, cult, having a different gospel. I mean, they've even got pictures of me that have been tampered with. Stories withholding information. And, of course, lies coupled with a little bit of truth. If it were not for the Holy Ghost in my body, it's a good thing I'm not suicidal. It's a good thing I don't take antidepressant drugs. Because so much stuff gets read about you. And you better expect this. If you are the bleep that you think you are on the radar, you better expect this. If you're just a little bleep in your community, imagine when you start traveling around the nation and you get a little bit more of a bleep. More people, the more people that know you, the more people are going to see. And we're wired. We want people to like us. I mean, who are we kidding here? We like people to like us. And when they start slamming us, we do take it very personal. The Bible says that we need to judge ourselves. Yeah. And as I said, he that is spiritual judges all things, but he himself is judged of no man. We do need to judge our motive, why we say things. And sometimes God may use a heathen to say something to try to correct you because you're blind.
Right.
And so you need to judge yourself. Every night I go to bed, You'll be surprised how I can fast forward conversations and things that happened and try to get these things done before I wake up the next day. The Bible teaches in 2 Chronicles 36:16, "But they mocked the messengers of God and despised his words and misused his prophets." Again, this is going on way before you and I. People have been despised and rejected. You're not alone, for heaven's sake. You think because something is written about you or something is said about you, you've just began the race. Just because somebody cranked out something about your name, don't think that you're Job. You've got a long way to go. The Bible says that David said, "They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of mine head."
Amen.
"That they will destroy me, being my enemies wrongfully are mighty." That's what David said. And that was a man after God's own heart. You would assume if you're after God's own heart, people are going to like you. You're going to be very much liked. We enjoy your company. No, actually, they're going to hate you. Again, he says, "They compassed me about also with words of hatred and fought against me without a cause." This is David. David also says, "I am a worm and no man, a reproach. I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people." Again, this is David. You think you have problems? He was a king.
That's right.
He was the king. Even David said in the prayer, "Because of thy sake, I have borne reproach. Shame has covered my face." Isaiah also understood this concept. "Hearken unto me," 51:7, "hearken unto me, ye that know righteousness, the people in whose heart is my law. Fear ye not the reproach of men, neither be afraid of their revealing. Isaiah stood with this persecution. He shed lights on the matter. He understood what was going on. If you're going to be a Christian, a very active Christian, one that wants to serve God, there's a lot of people before us that have been slandered. Jeremiah wrote, "Woe is me, my mother, that thou hast borne me, a man of strife, a man of contention, to the whole world." You think you've got problems because a few churches have issues with you? You think you have problems because people in your city despise you? You think you've got problems because somebody wrote something about you? The newspaper article kind of slandered your name a little bit. Jeremiah said he had problems with the whole world.
Mm.
That's big boy. That's big league stuff.
Amen.
You want to be wear the shoes that Jeremiah said? Hey, that little article, forget it. It's not the end of the world. The reality is, people are going to forget about that article by tomorrow when another article comes out. The only one that remembers it is you.
Right.
The Bible says in verse 15 of 15 in Jeremiah, "O Lord, thou knowest, remember me and visit me and revenge me of my persecutors. Take me not away in thy long suffering. I know that for thy sake I suffer rebuke." This is Jeremiah. He's suffering rebuke. These are the shoes that we're trying to fill today. And like I said, if you don't think you can handle it, hey, there's no questions asked. You're on the wrong bus. Get a transfer.
Amen.
And take another bus. But understand, you take this bus, there's going to be a little bumpy road. You better start gearing yourself. You better start gearing your loved one if you really want to talk the big leap stuff. That you know, honey, when you bury me, you better understand it's going to be a closed casket if the heathen have their way. I doubt I'm not going to die, you know, restfully in the sleep. Most likely what's going on with my life is some heathen's going to have his way. But I counted that cost. I understand that. I even had a detective in one city, forget what major city was at, he came up and he says, "You know, if we ever found your body in an alley, do you know how many millions of suspects we'd have to look into for you?"
Really?
And he was really upset over what we did in his city. Prophet Habakkuk said, "Why doest thou show me iniquity and cause me to behold grievance?" He's asking God, why are you showing me this stuff? You show it to me, I got to respond to it, and they hate me for it. "For spoiling and violence are before me," he says, "and they that rise up strife and contention." John the Baptist, of course, the Bible says, "For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and he had a devil." There's John with a devil. Jesus. Luke 22. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. That is a part of the condition you need to understand when in Luke 6:22. They need to hate you and separate you for the gospel's sake. Not because of your political stand, not because of your bank account, not because of the car you drive, not because of the color of your skin, not because of your surname, not because of who your employer is. If they hate you, it should be for the sake of the gospel.
Amen.
Not because you're an idiot and you said something stupid. It should be for the sake of the gospel.
Listen, Zach. He's preaching to you.
You listen.
Jesus was often asked, tell us by what authority thou do these things.
Bless you.
Or who is he that gave this authority? We taste this Bible verse a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, what church are you guys from?
Right.
Who's your pastor?
Mm-hmm.
Where did you get your education?
Mm-hmm.
Tell us by what authority do you do this?
Yes.
And the only reason we had come up with the name Bible Believers is because I've been kicked out of too many churches. And if I tell them I'm a Baptist, they know everything about me. If I tell them I'm a Pentecostal, they know everything about me.
Right.
If I tell them I went to the Assemblies of God Church, they know everything about me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I narrowed it down to two words for their sake, Bible believer. I believe in the Bible.
Amen.
In the 80s, they used to scream the sodomites, where church do you go to? We tell them Crystal Cathedral. Don't you guys come over to Robert's church, because we don't want you fags hanging around the parking lot with bricks around that building. We get very nervous.
Yeah.
Stay away from the Crystal Cathedral. Let Robert get a little bit of heat every once in a while. You've got to pass the love.
Amen.
Jesus was considered a glutton and a wine bibber, a friend of the publicans and sinners. Again, these are false accusations.
Yes.
You don't have Jesus talking to his disciples. Why are they doing this? Why are they saying that? Peter, he said that right there. Why didn't you jump on me and clarify that, guys? You don't have Jesus doing this. Yet when it happens to guys who said, I'm a modern-day John the Baptist, and somebody slanders them, they come crying to Uncle Reuben, and I got to put them over my shoulder and burp them. I mean, for crying out loud, you don't have Jesus walking around telling the disciples, I don't know why they just don't understand me. I can't understand this. Call them a wine bibber. In fact, the Pharisees went so far that they did some history on Jesus, and they said, we got something on you. We got something of you. You were born of fornication. We did some background on you, Jesus. We counted the days. We went to math school, and the numbers don't add up. Your age, and when Mary was pregnant, it doesn't add up. We got you now. You were born of fornication. Your Pharisee, your modern-day Pharisee, is going to try to dig dirt on you.
That's right.
He's going to dig, and it's in the Bible. Expect it. Expect it. Don't come crying to me when they dig something up on you. They went that far to Jesus to say, the numbers don't add up. You were born in fornication.
Yep.
The Bible says in Mark chapter 3, and the Pharisees went forth and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, on how they might destroy him.
That's right.
They didn't just try to slander Jesus. They didn't just try to say something against him. They didn't just say something about what he said. They wanted to destroy him. You want to see a modern-day Pharisee? That guy will go out of his way like the worker of iniquity. He will go out of his way. He will search the web. He will watch videos. He will have one motive in life, and that's to destroy you. And I tell you, I wish I would have his time. The time that I can have that he has just to hunt me down, I wish I can utilize that time. To me, if I was around when God created the world, I'd ask for a few more hours. I need a little bit more time. There's not enough time to do some of the things I'd sure like to do. But this guy is no different than the worker of iniquity. He takes time and makes time, and he's moved for one reason: to destroy you. And we don't find Jesus weeping and crying. We find Jesus having compassion on people, weeping for them. But we don't find him, you know, crying to his disciples. Why are they out to destroy me? Don't they know I'm a good guy?
Right.
I mean, I heal them. You know, I even healed the blind people, even though they're there protesting right now, bumping into each other. I healed them, and they're out there complaining. Jesus, the Bible says, warned us about being put out of the synagogues. And he even warned us that we were going to be killed. If all they do is slander you, be happy, because they would like to kill you. If all they do is slam your name, the end is they want to kill you. I did after Dearborn, I did a radio program in Israel, because they saw what we did in Dearborn. And after the radio program was done, I talked to a few people out there that we were still talking. And they said, "Reuben, I want to let you know right now, you better be living right, because you just shocked a lot of Muslims out here. And if they had it your way, they're going to tap into your computer, they're going to tap into your phone, they're going to tap into everything about you. And if there's anything that's in your background that's dirty, they're going to tag you. You have no idea the hornet's nest that you just kicked. And so, well, we better expect this. We're wired for this." That within itself should provoke us to live holy.
Right. Amen.
That within
Amen.
Itself should be Amen. Motive to live holy. If I'm 12 years old and I decide I want to be a politician like my great-grandfather, I better live right. Because whatever I do now, the media or somebody's going to throw it in my face when I'm running for office.
Right.
That within itself should motivate me to be an outstanding student. To be an A-grade student, to be the captain of the debate team, to be a captain on the football team. Because when they come and try to dig something on you, they're going to try to really find something against you. Pharisees tried to destroy Jesus. We had an interesting concept here in Matthew and Mark chapter 12. And what we've got, the only reason I'm using this, is we've got three different people coming up to Jesus. And again, they're trying to catch him on something so they can slander you. And you know, people are going to come up to you and talk to you. You can read them. After a while you do this, you can read people when they're walking up to you. It's as if they have a fluorescent blinking light
Amen.
As they're walking
Amen.
Up. You know, they're coming up to you, you can just see. Modern day Pharisee, come in right now. You know, homosexual. 11 o'clock, you know, atheist, 9 o'clock. You can just see these guys coming up before they even walk up to you.
Yeah.
Well, here we have a scenario in Mark chapter 12, and I encourage you to kind of read it when you do a little homework. We have three different groups that come up to Jesus. Group 1 walks up, and they say in verse 13 to 17, They send unto him certain Pharisees and of the Herodians to catch him in his words. That's their motive. Mm-hmm. And when they were come, they said unto him, "Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not?" Here you have these guys. Again, their motive is to catch Jesus, "Master." And what lovely words. You've got some modern-day Pharisee, and if you don't have your discernment, you better see that fluorescent word Pharisee coming on, right coming on their on top of their forehead or on top of their head. And they may say, brother, we really appreciate you. You know, I may have even seen you on YouTube. They may tell you something to try to get you to be won over. I read the last thing that you said. But they're trying to get Jesus on something. They know they can't nail Jesus. So what they're trying to do is they're trying to get Jesus to say something about the king so they can run to the king and say, you know what? This man's trying to start a coup.
Right.
You need to stop him.
Right.
That was their whole motive. They can't nail Jesus, so now they're trying to get him so that they can go to the king and say, we're going to turn this guy in. We're dropping a dime on this guy.
Mm-hmm.
He said he's the king. He's coming over. He's gaining momentum. Mm-hmm. He's got a lot of followers. You better watch this guy.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, of course, didn't speak against the king and the authorities and Rome, but he did somewhat answer their question. Maybe not according to what they wanted, but he did respond. Group 2, the Bible says, 18 through 26, then came unto him Sadducees, and they said, which say there is no resurrection, and they asked him, saying, and of course they did ask him about marriage, and again, this second group, they wanted to nail Jesus on doctrine. Now you had politics, now you have doctrine.
Right.
And of course, Jesus dealt with them. Mm-hmm. Their whole motive for both groups was to nail Jesus. Now, I only bring this point up because as open-air preachers, you better have discernment. You better not treat everybody the same.
Right.
You better know when to shift gears.
Yeah.
You better know that you can go nose-to-nose with somebody. And when somebody comes and asks you with the same exact question, this you just fired on this guy, but you see a meek, broken heart, tone down, and you can spend the rest
Amen.
Of the time with
it. Amen.
It happened here with Amen. Jesus. In group chapter, and in the third group, in the same chapter, the Bible says, and one of the scribes came, and they asked him, which is the greatest commandment? Jesus didn't respond to them the same way these guys. Jesus said, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and love thy neighbor as thyself. And of course, we understand the concept. If you love God, you're not going to have no other gods. If you love God, you're not going to bow down to no other gods. If you love God, you're not going to take his name in vain. If you love God, you're going to remember the Sabbath. If you love your fellow man, you're not going to lust after his wife. If you love your fellow man, you're not going to lie to him, steal from him, murder him. So, you know, Jesus, when he answered that question, he was right on the money. And the scribes agreed with Jesus. Jesus didn't say, you're going to hell. Jesus told this third group, thou art not far from the kingdom of God.
Right.
And the only reason I use this is for a learning process for us. Don't think everybody out there is out to slander you. I need you to understand that's going to happen. But you need to have enough discernment to know that you might have a bunch of different people coming, and this person here is extremely sincere. And for Jesus to make that statement, you're not far from the kingdom of God. He saw their motive was a little bit different, or they modified what they thought after they heard. Whatever happened, Jesus didn't handle them like the other two people. So that's something we need to understand. Expect slander. You better expect incoming. If you're the captain of your boat, you realize that boat is made with steel parts for a reason. You better expect some incoming hits. But it doesn't mean every vessel you see is an enemy. That vessel might be broken down and might need some help.
Amen.
And so it takes a little bit of discernment to understand that. Don't have this mentality that everybody's out to slander you. Expect it. But not everybody's going to slander you. Pick your battles. In the book of Acts, we read in Acts chapter 5, when the disciples were charged as they stood before the courts, and they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer for his name. Again, this should be your wiring. You shouldn't be saying, I can't believe they said this. I can't believe somebody wrote that. I can't believe they did a 30-minute YouTube clip just on me. I can't believe they wrote a track about me. You better expect this stuff. If you think you're as big as you are in the radar, you better expect it. Otherwise, quite frankly, I hate to be blunt, you're not even a bleep on the radar. Maybe a little bleep on your own hometown, but when it comes to your county, you might not be a bleep. When it comes to your state, you're not even on the radar. And when it comes to the nationwide, boy, you know, who are you? So again, you may say you're somebody big. I say if you say you're somebody big, you should know slander is coming right behind you. And you should expect it. Rejoice. Be glad when this stuff happens. Don't feel obligated that you have to go and defuse every argument. There's so much stuff to get said on me on Facebook. Maybe every once in a while I might respond. For the most part, I let it go. It's not the big thing. If a person wants to believe something about me, and even if I clarified that point, it would be something else he wouldn't like.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And it would be something else he heard that I said.
That's right.
It would be another video that he saw. It would be another picture that he saw of me. There was somebody once that had a big thing. I had a sandwich sign that said, "God abhors you." And, you know, they're assuming I'm walking around preaching at everything with this "God abhors you" sign. You know, I'm going to a Disneyland in front of Disneyland with a "God abhors you" sign. Yeah, I believe that.
You're not?
But, you know, you're only going to wear that sign where it's needed.
Right.
But this guy's not going to put that out. He's going to just assume that we're just preaching this everywhere all the time. I've got banners for all kinds of occasions.
Amen.
So, we need to understand that we should rejoice when people slander us. The Bible says, and this gives a little insight in Acts chapter 13, "But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy and spake against those things which were spoken by Paul." They were filled with envy. The motive for these guys to slander you and mock you and make fun of you is envy. They wish they could do what you do. They would like to do what you do.
Amen.
I've got some guys that want to preach, but not like us, and they'll, they're envious. They can't gather a crowd and maintain a crowd.
Right.
At best, they just love to, grab some of the people that you're working with. They're envious of what it is you do. And so, understand that's their motive. That verse in Acts 13, that's a good piece to the jigsaw puzzle to have as to why people will slander you. Of course, Brother Matt brought up Acts 24, where Paul was a pestilent fella. He was all even called a ringleader, mover of sedition. Again, this is gossip.
Mm-hmm.
It happened to Paul. I've got tons of verses where the slander continues. Acts 24, when Paul was in prison for 2 years, Felix succeeded by Festus. And because Felix wanted to gain favor with the Jews, he left Paul in prison because of the slander of the Jews. Paul stayed in jail a bit longer. In Acts 28, the Bible says, when Paul was giving his testimony, "But we desire to hear of thee what thou thinkest. As for concerning this sect, we know that everywhere it is spoken against." Everywhere Paul goes, it is spoken against. He's not a very likable guy. They tried to kill him. And Paul didn't say, "Well, I'm just going to walk out in Jesus' name and bind everybody." At one point, they had to sneak him down the backside of a building at night in a basket.
Amen.
Because of slander. People hated him. Paul writes to the church in Rome, "And not rather as we slanderously report, as some may affirm that we say." Paul is again, in much of his epistles in Corinthians, and again, we always know the fruit of the Holy Ghost, but we never consider slander being fruitful. Peter writes, "Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, Peter expects to be called an evil doer. The tons of verses are everywhere, and I didn't really want to go through all of them. Usually when I'm trying to give you a verse, I'll just quickly read through them because I didn't want to spend time trying to dig them out. But I've got all the addresses if you're interested. But the Bible is filled with slander. If you have issues with that, just read the Bible. It's in the book. They slandered from the Old Testament, from the beginning of the New Testament, throughout the Bible. They will slander your name.
Amen.
The two witnesses found in the book of Revelation, the Bible says, they tormented the world. These two guys tormented the world. You're talking some big league open air preaching.
Yes.
Right.
You think you caused a little stir on campus? Well, quite frankly, it was just the grid of that campus. You think you caused a big stir in that city? Well, it was just a few streets in that city. These big boys, when they walked around, they tormented the world. That's some big league preaching. You don't think there was some slander being said around those fellas? We've walked into something, and if you're concerned about your good name, I'd say get a transfer and get off the bus. Thank you.
Amen.